Good morning again, everybody. For all of you out there, welcome to the Grace Christian Fellowship. Turn on my microphone, that way people can actually hear me. So, we'd go through the bulletin this morning, but I gave Sarah Prather the day off, because normally she'll even take bulletin notes on days when they are taking off. So I was like, no, you guys, don't worry about that. So there you go. But the events really haven't changed. So we've done Wednesday prayer. So send a text out your way. And if I don't text you, let me know. Or send an email. Let me know what your prayer requests are. Or even we still have little note things over there. So let us know. You know, you can put that in there and let us know what your prayer requests are and such like that. Or just give me a phone call. Say, hey, pray for me for this. Any of those things will work. And so that's what we do. And then we'll do a list so that everybody can be praying for us on Wednesday. There you go. So if there anything else going on, keep praying. And now last week, this whole last week, Juanita, was the Royal Family Kids Club Camp. So was that the last event for the summer? So, or is there one more event coming?
We're actually having camp.
Okay, camp is coming at the end of July, usually, isn't it?
Yes. But this year it's only 3 days.
So everybody keep just be in prayer for the kids and everything, all the foster kids at the end of the month. This is their chance to be loved on, their chance to be accepted, their chance to see Jesus in other people's lives, especially since in their lives they've been torn apart and ripped apart by, unfortunately, usually the parents. And so, which, you know, a lot of times people's view of God is formed by how they see their parents, especially their father. You know, when their fathers are abusive or absent, that colors their view of God. And so just be in prayer for these kids so that they will see the father that is really there for them. All right, so on that note, let's get ready to dive into God's word and let's pray. Father, we just thank you for this morning. Thank you for who you are, that you are our Father, and that you are a good Father, and that you love us and care for us. You sent your Son to die for us, and I just praise you for that. I pray now as we get ready to worship you in the Word, Lord, that you would open up the Word to us. Help us to see, Father. Help us to understand what we need to understand for us. Pray that it would stick to our hearts and soul, and that as we hear it, as we see it, that would put our lives to action, Lord. And I just ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. We're going to finish Daniel chapter 8 today. Call this lesson God's Schedule. You'll see why as we go forward. Before I really introduce the lesson here, I want us to just read, so if you've got your Bibles, hopefully you do, you're in Daniel chapter 8, I'm not going to put it on the overhead, I want you to hear it and listen or read it if you have your Bibles. So Daniel chapter 8, verse 9 through 12, and then we're going to take a look at verse 23 and 25, because that's where Gabriel is giving the interpretation. So verse 9 through 12. Tells about what we've been talking about, this Antichrist figure. It says, out of one of them, out of this four horns that were there of the Greek Empire, came a little horn, which grew exceedingly great towards the south, towards the east, and toward the glorious land. It grew great even to the host of heaven, and some of the host and some of the stars it threw down to the ground and trampled on them. Verse 11, it became great, even as great as the prince of the host. And the regular burnt offering was taken away from him, and the place of his sanctuary was overthrown. Verse 12, and the host was given over to it together and with the regular burnt offering because of transgression. And it will throw truth to the ground, and it will act and prosper. So then the interpretation by Gabriel. It says, at the latter end of their kingdom, when the transgressors have reached their limit, a king of bold face who understands riddles shall rise. His power shall be great, but not by his own power. And he shall cause fearful destruction and shall succeed in what he does and destroy mighty men and the people who are the saints. By his cunning he shall make deceit prosper under his hand, and in his mind he shall become great. Without warning he shall destroy many, and he shall even rise up against the prince of princes, and he shall be broken, but by no human hand. So there you go. So that, the basic scripture discussing the Antichrist, both Daniel's initial vision, and then Gabriel giving some explanation. So Caleb covered the last parts of those, talking about the cunning deceit that this Antichrist will have, this person that is also called the beast, the man of lawlessness. He's a deceiver, just like his father, Satan. You know, and so that's one of those. It's one of those scriptures you could just really point out, because we see deception all around us all the time. It's been interesting. I've been reading this book. It's called Disinformation. And it's written by a former Romanian general who defected to the West in 1978. And his whole story he's talking about, his whole thing is he's talking about the Soviet intelligence's use of disinformation and this cunning and deceit that he would do. And what the thing is, it's very surprising to understand that he said that most of their intelligence service, you know, because when you think of spies, you think of assassins, you think of guys stealing information. That's what you think of when you think of spies. But he said the large majority, almost two-thirds of their efforts was not into that. It was into spreading disinformation. Because disinformation is powerful, very powerful. All you have to do is plant an allegation in somebody's, about somebody that might be close to the truth, because it doesn't have to be totally true, just something that's partially true, and you can wipe it out. You can go after them. And that's the thing that the devil is going to do in his cunning towards God. Caleb did a really good job talking about all the doctrines, those key points. And keep in mind, the devil is going to go against every single one of those doctrines. He's going to try to twist them. He's going to use disinformation to take them down. Exactly. And what was interesting is this guy talked about with the fall of, he wrote the book in like 2003, I think. He said, you know, even though the Soviet Union fell, all of its arms of disinformation stayed there. They're all still in action. With the goal, with a two-pronged goal. One is to take down the United States through disinformation. The other is to take down the church. You must remember, even today we see folks going on out there with, you know, when I see the certain stuff happening that is promoting Marxism. Promoting it. You know, whenever you hear somebody talk about critical theory. That's the basic. That's the basic idea. It's been spread out in other different ideas. But critical theory, the whole idea is to wipe out any information and to go after it and attack it and tear it apart, making it oppose each other. And so that's what's been done. That's what they're going to do to the church. They're going to do to God. They're going to do for Jesus. They're going to go after the leaders and everything else. Disinformation is still there. Now, with all that in mind, thinking about these things, thinking about how this is happening, why this is happening, how long this would happen, that is a question we would all want to know. A lot of us want to know, you know, everybody wants to know, when is the end times? When is that going to happen? We don't know. But one of the great things that the Bible has furnished us with information about is how long it will be. And that's important, because when we think about unscheduled things that happen in our lives, unscheduled things sometimes can have a fun excitement, like a surprise party. can have fun excitement or unscheduled things, can have, you know, not so exciting things, and just like, or negatively exciting. You're like, oh no, a flat tire, I did not schedule this on the day's events, and then it ruins everything else. And but nothing is more exciting than scheduled events. When you know, especially the good stuff, when a graduation is scheduled, you know, especially for kids, when they're getting ready to graduate, they're like, there's that date, I'm gonna be done with this stuff, and that's exciting. You know, a holiday, you know, whether we think of Christmas or any of the other holiday, when it's got a date, you know when it's coming. It's like right there. As soon as it's done, 365 days from now, it's going to be there again. You know, and so it's exciting. You know it's coming. Anniversaries, or, you know, even right up close to home, and you're not thinking, I can't wait a year. Sometimes it's payday. Payday is like, oh, here comes payday. That's exciting. I got money. Woohoo! I can go spend something. You know, so it's exciting. But it's also just as true to know that trying times will also end. That's good to know. It's good to know. Like, if you're going to take that test, and you know that the test is not a never-ending test, but it only has 20 questions. Yay, it only has 20 questions. Because imagine just sitting at the endless test. Like, when is this going to end? Or, you know, for me, back in the day, I went to boot camp. Well, you know, I knew something about boot camp. The boot camp was only 8 weeks long. Woohoo! It wasn't going to be a forever boot camp. You know, so it had an end to that trying time. You know, that some think of the worst of circumstances like a prisoner. They're given a sentence. They're going to, like, you're going to have 20 years. Or maybe just a probation. Maybe you're going to be in there for 90 days. But still, there it is. It's a set time. Gives you a goal. Understands where things are going. So that trying time still has something that allows you to know, some comfort to know that it's coming to an end. The reason that when we think about this, is as we've been looking at the book of Daniel, we remember that some of these things that Daniel's been looking at has made him very uncomfortable, very disturbed. He is seeing stuff about his people, about the countries around him, the whole situation. He understands something because everything that's on there is like big overview, seeing the big picture, but we realize this is involving a lot of people. You know, when all these different entities come through, that means a lot of people are going to be getting killed. With each turnover of an empire, the soldiers of the previous ones are going to be wiped out. And the society is going to be changed and affected, and many people will be enslaved or all those things. He understands that. He's worked in the government there for many years. He knows how all this is going to play out. And for him, he's been there. He was taken away from his home, forced into slavery. So he knows the emotions, the pain, the disturbance of what this all would mean for anybody. So that you can understand that he would be very disturbed knowing his people would endure horrific times ahead. When would they end? When would they end? So now we want to think about, we're going to introduce the idea of prophetic time. At least that's what I call the title. Hopefully it explains something and makes us think about how God does prophecy. So let's come to Daniel 8:13. He says, "Then I," that would be Daniel, "heard a holy one speaking," or another holy one said to the one who spoke. So they're kind of having a conversation. So Daniel's listening in. He says, "For how long is the vision concerning the regular burnt offering, the transgression that makes desolate, and the giving over of the sanctuary and host to be trampled underfoot?" So Daniel's overhearing this conversation, a holy one speaking and another holy one. Keep in mind, he hasn't come to the interpretive section yet, to where he gets to hear Gabriel. So he doesn't know this guy's name yet. We know it because a few verses from this, in verse 15 and 16, we get introduced to Gabriel. But he doesn't know, he just hears these guys talking. And they, not Daniel ask a very pertinent question. Very pertinent question. They said, for how long is this vision going to be? Especially for these different events. See, God, that's the thing, is sometimes it talks about in the Bible where the Holy Spirit will sometimes pray in ways that we don't even know. That's why when we have our Wednesday night prayer here, we always at the beginning not just say, ask the Lord to be with us, but we ask Him to guide us in our prayers. Because when you guys tell us your situations, so often you tell us what you want, but we know that God might be desiring other outcomes. And so we pray for that. Pray for how the Lord will do His work in your lives and hearts. And so, here he is. God knows what Daniel and Israel need to know. They need to know the duration of what this horrible person will do. So, God is good at this. Even before Daniel, there's been a pattern in Israel's history of God telling them how long things would be, especially bad things. God, Noah. How long did God tell Noah it would be raining? 40 days and 40 nights. He labeled it out. He said, this is what's going to happen. How long it would be. How long this stuff would be happening. So it was very clear. Sometimes when we think of Israel in a big time frame, we don't necessarily remember that God told Abraham exactly how long the Israelites would be in Egypt. You realize that? He said exactly how long they would be there. In Genesis 15, verse 13 and 14, it says, then the Lord said to Abram, know for certain that your offspring will be sojourners in a land that is not theirs, and will be servants there, and they will be afflicted for 400 years. But I will bring judgment on the nation that they serve, and afterward they shall come out with great possession. So there it is. Abram's being told, it's like, this is what's going to happen. And this everything that he was told was a couple 300 years before that even happened. Before Moses even showed up or anything like that. So long time frame. It's just like, but he said what was going to happen. He gave them a time limit of how long they were going to be there. Very fascinating. Then remember when Joseph was given his vision while he was in Egypt? He went to Pharaoh. Pharaoh had that dream. He said, I had a dream of seven healthy cows, and then I had a dream of, or seven unhealthy cows came and ate the healthy ones. And Joseph's like, well, what are you telling you? There's, you're going to have 7 good years, but then you're going to have 7 bad years. So he knew exactly what it was going to be. He knew what the time frame was that would happen. And God seems to have these big picture times. I was looking at Isaiah earlier this morning. And Isaiah is broken up just almost like the Bible. In verse chapter 40 is almost like, starts almost a New Testament message. But in that, it's like right after they're told that they're going to be sent to Babylon and everything is going to be bad. But then right after that, in chapter 40, he says, but God's going to get you out of there. God's going to rescue you. In other words, letting them know it wasn't going to be forever. It wasn't going to be bad news. And so that's how God works. So soon, Daniel is going to be given the timetables. Some very specific ones. Matter of fact, so specific, it's just amazing. And he's one of the key ones that's given exacting numbers, which is just fascinating. So we'll be introduced to some today. The thing is, when we think about prophetic time, the biblical worldview is about time. I mean, if you think about that, it's like, well, Robbie, how would you say that? But even from Genesis, remember, it didn't say, well, just God created this, and then God created that. He adds time and element in there. He says, a day, morning, and evening. Now, personally, I think he really did it in 6 literal days. Maybe he did, maybe he didn't. But he still gives us the timing. It's very important to him. He's like, in other words, God in a linear scale is saying, I do things in an ordered, timely manner. Not willy-nilly. That's amazing to think about. Our God holds himself to that. He doesn't have to, but he does. That is very unique when you think of worldviews out there of what God does compared to everybody else in this linear time thing. Especially since I believe that God exists both outside of time. That's how he knows every event. He knows every possibility. If I'm going along and I make a decision to go right, God knows everything that's going to happen if I make a right-hand turn. But if I go along and make a left, he also knows every possibility in that left-hand turn. He knows. It's amazing. That's a big God who can know all those things. And then what's even more amazing is he can then work his will within my decisions. That's powerful. That's why when he gives prophecy, some people are like, well, that must mean he's like meticulously controlling everything. No. But he can influence everything to still make everything happen exactly the way he wants it to. Wow. Amazing. So time. Everything seems to have this connection with time. What's interesting is God, even when Moses starts getting the law, God gives him some stuff all about time. He gives him celebrations. He says, hey, you're going to do these kind of festivals. You're going to have like Yom Kippur. You're going to have the Feast of Tabernacles. You're going to do all these feasts in a certain time frame. So he has time in mind. He wants them to keep time important to them, not just for the seasons. You know, some people are like, oh yeah, you got to have the time so you know when to plant, know when to harvest, all those things. You know, that's great and all. But God wants them to celebrate not that, but him. And so he's paying attention to his own timetable. Then you think about prophecy that constantly you see, like the phrase that we talked about before, the day of the Lord. We mentioned that the day of the Lord isn't like just one. There's multiple days of the Lord. But it's there. It's like a time. Something's happening at a particular time, particular judgment that God is going to do. When he steps into time, does something miraculous, does something different, it becomes a day of the Lord where he moves in and does his work particularly. Then you think about the idea we're going to see, especially in Daniel here, where we're even told at the end of Daniel chapter 9 the exact timing when Jesus came into Jerusalem. Given exact dates. And that's just fantastic to think of, because what that did is it defined time. It says, God says, I'm doing things on my schedule. That's the thing. The enemy can work against God and do all sorts of God, like, yeah, yeah, you can keep doing whatever. But I'm going to keep my schedule. Because God's like, I'm running the train here. This is what's going to happen. This is how it's going to happen. That's why when you think of, like, when Jesus was born, and even then Herod tried to take out Jesus. That's when the enemy was trying to interrupt God's schedule. All the different times. Remember when people were trying to kill Jesus? Again, trying to interrupt the schedule. Even trying to get him to be king before he was time. He says, no, no, no. I have a schedule. And so that's very interesting to think about. Then to provide a context of what was so important, this angel tells them, it's like, okay, we want to know when these things are done, how long it's going to last, about what exactly. And remember, he said this in Daniel 8:13 again. He says, concerning the regular burnt offering, the transgression it makes desolate, and the giving over of the sanctuary and the host. So here's this angelic being, representative of God, is saying, this is what I am paying attention to. This, I'm not just talking about what's happening to your people, but God's place on earth is being wiped out. And this is bad news. It shows the importance and priority that he was thinking about. He talks about the regular burnt offering. Not that we don't always realize that, because for us, when we come into church on Sunday, once a week. Some of us do events during the middle of the week. But for them, every day they had a burnt offering. And this is talked about in Exodus 29:38. It says, now this is what you shall offer on the altar. Two lambs, a year old, day by day, regularly. So this was happening all the time. They were every day in the temple offering these lambs. That's why even today, when there is no temple, they want the temple. They want to build it. Because they have not been able to do this. And that's, there's a phrase that we're going to see where it talks about the Gentiles, the time of the Gentiles is keeping them from that moment. And then he said the other thing that was important in Daniel 8:13, let's go forward to bring it up again. He talks about the transgression that makes desolate. And we're going to talk about this a little bit more down the line, but this is the event where the temple desecration. Remember he talked about that the Antichrist and via Antiochus Epiphanes went into the temple and poured pig's blood all over everything, put a statue of himself in there. You know, really, well, it was Zeus Jupiter is what he said it was, but it had his face on it, which is always very handy. But there it is, this desecration. I guess in the Maccabees it describes worse. I'm just giving you the clean details because it got worse. You know, just the bad news, what he was doing, the mockery and the things that he was doing to try to destroy it, to make it desolate. And that's why when it uses the word abomination of desolation, it wasn't kidding around. It was an abomination. It was something like when you go by something like the smell of the sewer, you're like, oh, whoa, what's that? Yeah, and then you're like, that smell is an abomination. that's the way it would hit their hearts and minds and souls. This, what he was doing was so gross, so nasty, that it was an abomination. And he said, that's what's going on. And then it says, giving over the sanctuary and host. So this, the temple and the army that gathered would, that they were affected. Everything was affected by what was going on. But nobody was there to fight for them. It's like, why is this not happening? When is that going to end? Because all this is focused on the last part of the verse, which is next in Daniel 8:13, the last part of it there, concerning all of this would be trampled underfoot. So trampled underfoot. This is just a great graphic illustration of the humiliation this nation was going to get at. And what it was pointing at was the merciless brutality of it all. See, it's one thing that, you know, when you're like playing a soccer game, I remember my daughter Amanda played soccer, she played defense, and I was amazed how much tackling actually happened in soccer. I would have thought I was watching football, but no, it was soccer, and they were like, just crashed right into each other. I was like, man. But the great thing is when they, you know, they would usually get back up. Of course, you'd always get the one to like play off of the injury, like oh, looking around at the ref, he's getting it going, trying to draw that foul kind of thing that's going on. But imagine if in the game, if you know, I could just see it as a dad, as the offensive player hit Amanda and then just started tromping on her. I'd be like, whoa, this is that you've just taken it a little bit too far there. And then we do that in all the sports. If you see it in football, after they get done, they get it out of the scrum, and they have players they've seen where they purposely stepped on them, and the refs get them. And I was just like, personal foul. And they go after them, like, no, that's wrong. Don't do that. Because it's humiliating to be trampled on like that. And the imagery, this was already used before in Daniel already, when Daniel was describing the fourth beast, the Roman Empire, in Daniel 7:23, when he says, thus he said, as for the fourth beast, there shall be a fourth kingdom on the earth, which shall be different from all the other kingdoms, and it shall devour the whole earth and trample it down, and break it to pieces. So there's that idea. The Romans would just humiliate everybody. They were just trampling them down, truly. So he used that. He's using that phrase. Daniel really likes that phrase quite a bit, and it gets revealed to him quite a bit. Jesus evoked this imagery as he described what would happen to the nation of Israel that had rejected their Messiah. Remember, he said there was going to be a price to pay for that. Luke 21, verse 24, he says, and they, that would be Israel, will fall by the edge of the sword and led captive among the nations, and Jerusalem will be trampled underfoot by the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles are fulfilled. So remember I was just talking about that. That's a timetable of God. That's something that's like even today, right in the middle of where the temple should be, the Al-Aqsa Mosque is there. The Dome of the Rock, where allegedly Jesus, or not Jesus, Muhammad, was raised from the ground to go up there. So they are mocking the Jewish people by keeping that place there. And so they can't build their temple there because the Al-Aqsa Mosque is right in the middle of their territory, where the temple should be. And so they're waiting for that time to when somehow, and that's why they talk about, when we get to Daniel 9, chapter 9, where he makes a covenant, that the beast, the Antichrist, makes a covenant with them to make that, most people believe it, to make that happen, to be able to usher in peace, to somehow broker a way to be able to put the temple and to start to rebuild the temple again. But he can't do that until that time frame is done. Revelation also used this phrase to describe the events of that temple and the future. Because see that they start to build the temple, but then in Revelation 11:2 it says, for it is the temple given over to the nations, and they will trample the holy city for 42 months, which is 3.5 years. Because Daniel's going to tell us at the end of Daniel chapter 9, that he breaks the deal halfway through. Very much like we see the guy in Antiochus Epiphanes, where he goes through the town, go to Egypt, and then he comes back, and then he decides to get rid of all the Jews and go after them. He breaks his peace with them to hurt them and to persecute them. And so here's these phrases, the idea of being trampled down in the city, and it's about Jerusalem, and it uses these phrases. In other words, they were going to be humiliated. Nothing's worse than being humiliated. Humiliation just, it hurts you. So they want to know, how long? How long would this be? And then Gabriel, we find out, answers this question. We know it's him. But Daniel doesn't know it yet. In verse 14, Daniel 8:14, and he said to me, so he turns to Daniel, so they get the question asked, and he turns to Daniel to tell him. It says, for 2,300 evenings and mornings, then the sanctuary will restore it to its rightful state. Wow. 2,300 evenings and mornings, a very, very definitive answer. I mean, right to the money. It's like, this is what's going to happen. Exactly. No vagaries here. Not like, well, it'll be done at some point in time. It's going to be a little bit of time. No. 2,300 evenings and mornings. And thus Daniel had, and when you think about this, Daniel's recording this. His prophetic status is on the line. Because remember, a prophet of God can't, like, be vague. Not like, you know, like when we see, you know, if you look at the astrology stuff in the newspaper, almost every one of them almost says the same thing. You know, today you're going to meet a stranger when you know, and have a really good day. It's like, Well, what does that mean? Yeah, that can be anything. It's so vague. It's so self-fulfilling, if you will. But here it's like, no, there's no way around this. It has to happen that way. Now, 2,300 evenings and mornings. What does that mean? How does that all work out? Well, there's two different ways of looking at this. So we'll bring them up here for a second. The most popular one is just a straightforward 2,300 days of 24-hour time period. So that's one of the ways to take a look at it. And there's some good reason to believe that, and I'll come back at that in a second. The other one would be temple-oriented. This is 2,300 because he uses the word, the phrase, evenings, mornings. Now, in our English version, it says evenings and mornings. But in the Hebrew, it just says evening, mornings. That's it. So it's quite possible it's talking about how the temple did things. Because, remember in Exodus, I read you Exodus 29:38, and verse 39 talks about that when you shall offer the altar two lambs a year old day by day regularly, one lamb you shall offer in the morning, the other lamb you shall offer it at twilight. So there's that. So now I messed up on this one here, so if you want to go back to the other one, okay, great. So there it is. They get these daily evening and morning, or evening and morning sacrifices. Remember, the Sabbath always started in evening time. So that's what they're dealing with. So it's possible that this fulfilled it in this way. Now, the first one there, the reason why that could work very well is if you look at when Antiochus IV invaded, was right around 170 BC. And the temple was restored in 164 BC. Roughly 6 years. Because that's about what the time frame is there. Because when you look at the 2,300 days, that's 6 years, 4 months, and 20 days. That's how that adds out. Then if you think about the second method, that the temple oriented is quite possible because it would match the time when the temple was actually desecrated. When he came in and did what he did, and because that adds up to being 3 years, 1 month, and 10 days. And it's a lot of people have said that from the December of 167 BC to December 25th, 163 BC, in their timing would add up to that. There that is. So very possible, either one. And I'm not going to bore you with extraneous details on how they all figured that out, because there's people, like many everybody else, all the commentators, all said, everybody's arguing and trying to figure that out. The bottom line is, I believe it literally came true one way or another, and the Jewish people know this, because otherwise they would have denigrated Daniel. They would say, oh, well, this, at 2,300 days, that didn't work out, didn't happen, but they knew it happened. So I'm going to go with that. So in other words, they know Daniel, yeah, he's a prophet all the way. They're on board because they must know something about the timing that we haven't been able to figure out. So that makes Daniel, again, his position's legit. Also something to consider when we look at this is, because a lot of people will take this 2,300 days and then you start to leap around in the Bible where it has other events that are pretty close. Because, like I've already shared with you, that the book of Revelations is a 7 year period divided into 2 3.5 year periods. So that's how everybody, you can see it as you go through it, it's pretty straightforward. And so 3.5 years is 42 months. So they try to squeeze it into that, but it's more than that. It's more than 3.5 years. So it doesn't squeeze very good. You have to start doing some stretching exercises, some biblical stretching stuff to make it all happen. But you don't need to do that at all. Why, Robbie, would you say? Because these numbers are not for every other prophetic event. They're a type of those other events, but it's specifically for when Antiochus Epiphanes was there. It's specifically for him. Giving specific numbers for that moment in time of when he was going to be there to comfort them and to let them know exactly what was going on. And it makes it clear that that way this desolation would have a specific time and it would end. Which is very comforting to know. It's like, okay, this Yahoo isn't going to be in charge. He's not going to continue doing what he's doing. They went back to the book of Daniel. Like, look, it's only going to last 2,300 evenings and mornings, whatever that may be. It's got a finite end. And the messenger makes this clear for Daniel. As we proceed forward and go up to Daniel 8:14, where he says specifically, then the sanctuary shall be restored to its rightful state. That's the whole idea. That's the goal. That's what these angelic beings, they're thinking about God. See, usually when we're in weird circumstances and trying circumstances, who are we thinking about? We're thinking about ourselves. We're like, man, this hurts. This is a pain. This is really annoying for me. But they're reminding us of the big picture's perspective. This is blasphemous towards God. And that's always so true, man. I don't know about you guys, but I can get very selfish. I can get very selfish between me and God. But I want God to do things my way because, you know, the world revolves around me. Right? I know it doesn't revolve around you, because I'm thinking about me. But we all know the real truth is that God's the center of everything. That's where we, when all of us, we're always in conflict. Because our flesh, who is still with us, still in the redeeming process until the day we die, is in conflict with God. It wants to be in charge. It wants to run the show. It wants to, like, me. And God says, no. And that's the truth of it. That's the battle. Now, when we think about how Gabriel, remember he talked about the translation of this, gave it some interpretation. In verse 26, he talks about it just briefly. He says in Daniel 8:26, it says, the vision of the evenings and the mornings that has been told is true. So he says, there it is. So this date, those times, that 2,300 evenings and mornings was true. He's like, there it is. That's it. It's very true. And he says, seal up the vision, for it refers to many days from now. So he's like, it's not going to happen immediately. It's going to happen at some point in the future. So just keep this under wraps, if you will. Now, when we think about Daniel, as we bring this to a close this morning, I already mentioned it, you know, he was disturbed about some of these things. And now we're going to see, because we have to remember, these prophets of God, they were human beings like you and I. And we see that Daniel is very much concerned. And he's remarkable. Because he's not thinking about himself. He's thinking about his people. He's thinking about God. Thinking about all these other folks. His life has been remarkable for that. Remember, even when Nebuchadnezzar was going crazy and hanging out in the garden, chewing on leaves and stuff, Daniel could have took over the kingdom. He could have told others to have him quietly put down. I mean, he was crazy. He could have done that, but he protected him. Daniel selflessly kept Nebuchadnezzar there, his enemy. That shows his selflessness. And this comes out again in this final scripture where Daniel 8:27, and he closes out this vision. He says, and I, Daniel, was overcome and lay sick for some days. Then I rose and went about the king's business, but I was appalled by the vision, did not understand it. See, sometimes in Christian circles nowadays, not so much here, I try to avoid it here, but everybody's like, oh yeah, have your best life by Friday. And everything's going to be hunky-dory and rosy. That's the life of a Christian, you know. Apple pie and goodness all the time. But that's not true. You know, sometimes. And we can have a good outlook on things to try to make the best of a situation. But often it is a struggle. And here we have Daniel's admission. He didn't have to put this, but he does. He tells us that, like, this was bad news. This was really rocking his world. And sometimes God will rock our world. He was overcome. The King James Version said he was fainting. In other words, he was weak from it. It was just like, it was getting right there where he was just like, oh, it was just so in his heart that he could barely stand. Back to said he lay sick. He was physically ill from the knowledge of what he knew now. That's not a happy message. That's where he was at. He was not feeling good. Body was trying to be normal. That's all of us, isn't it? Sometimes life is just punching us right in the gut. And we got to still get about our business, though. And that's what he does. He gets about the business and does it. That's what we got to do sometimes. We got to just stand back up. But I know from Scripture that God helps us do that. It's like, takes us by the hand and says, come on, let's keep going. But he says that he was appalled by the vision still, which means that he was like astonished. It's just like, whereas have you ever had something on your mind, maybe a bad event or that, you know, that conversation that you're having with somebody else that you can't have with them ever, and you're having it ongoing, it's on eternal playback in your mind, just keeps going and you're just thinking about it. That's where he's at. He's probably going over this again and again and again. Just, this is what's going to happen. So he's thinking about that. And it says that he did not understand it. See, sometimes that's the mystery of Christian life sometimes, is we are still encountering mysteries. There's so much about the Lord that I don't know. So much that we don't know. We don't know so many things of how he loves us. When I think of that mystery, like, I know that he does. But that he does is amazing to me, that he would even consider that. That he would do that. That he sent his son. Why do that? Look at us, Lord, look at us. We don't deserve that. But he did. That's a mystery. Then when we're going through, he said, there's still going to be suffering. But why, Lord? Why didn't you just, the moment I said, oh yes, Lord Jesus, I accept you as my Savior, I receive your great forgiveness and grace, and then that moment the big light shined and boom, we're gone. Wouldn't that have been just great? Of course, I could just see that in the Billy Graham Crusade or Greg Laurie Harvest, that half the stadium just disappeared. Of course, oh, there's a problem. There would have been no Greg Laurie tell anybody about anything. There would have been no Christians there to take them to the, because they all would have just been gone. We have to endure. We have to go through it. But, as I've just told you already, we already know that when the end comes, when it really does come, it's 7 years. We know how it'll go. I believe we'll be raptured ahead of time. And if we're not, well, then I know the schedule. I'll know the schedule. And that'll comfort me. Comfort my heart. It'll comfort us all. Because that's what God wants to do. And that's what, in Isaiah chapter 40, the very first verse, he talks about comforting Jerusalem. He says, I'm speaking words of comfort to her. Because he knew what she had gone through. Even though the schedule was on time, they still had to endure. And they needed comfort. And you know what? Our God is the God of all comfort. Praise the Lord. Father, we just thank you for this message from Daniel. We thank you, Lord, that you have a schedule. And that you're working your will and your way and your purposes, even now, and it will be right on time. Father, I thank you for that. But Lord, I also thank you that before then, as we're walking through our days here, and that things don't always go right, and we get that stomach punch from life, that, Lord, you understand, and you're with us in that moment. So, Father, I just pray for that. I pray that we would understand that, and we would know your presence, and that even what we're suffering through, that at some point, that too will end. We just praise you. Thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and worship the Lord one more time.
Bless the Lord.